patience and your perseverance. And we all have persistence in getting through the program and getting through the issues that people have talked about. We're going to change the video that was going to be shown at the end of the day today till tomorrow. So that eases the day a little bit. So at the end of the day tomorrow, there'll be the video, The Great Fight for Disability Rights. We're going to start this panel. We have a lot of people. There are, well, there should be five. And we're now going to switch to a discussion of Article 19. I'm asking the panel to, I know they're condensing material and condensing their slides, but to do it by not talking more quickly so that we respect the human rights of the person who has been recording every word that we have said. And we're going to begin with a discussion from Israel, which has been a leader in the world in the process of deinstitutionalization. And so Michal is going to start us off. I got it. Take your paper, wherever you're comfortable.
I apologize up front because I'm going to fly through a few of the slides and you can see them on the website, okay? So as you can see, I changed a little bit the topic of my talk, and I'm going to talk about deinstitutionalization in Israel of persons with intellectual disabilities. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the past, the present, and looking into the future. Okay. So a few words about what is deinstitutionalization. First of all, we know that over the last few decades, there has been a dramatic decline in the number of people who with intellectual disabilities who reside in institutions. This is not by chance. This was maneuvered by policy, as a result of policy entitled reinstitutionalization, the transition of people with intellectual disabilities from institutions to community-based services, and it is a central policy in Western countries. Okay? Something is off. I'm going to skip this slide, but you can look at it later. It's a little bit about, from the social science literature, a little bit about the history of deinstitutionalization, just for you to know that it's not a new concept. Although now it's talked about all over the world, it's a concept that emerged in the 1960s. And I'm going to skip this slide, okay. And also this slide, which compares Israel to other countries, I will focus on Israel now completely. Okay, so first of all, our institutions in Israel are entrenched, or they are based, they get funded from this law, the Care for People with Mental Retardation Act of 1969. Still, the wording is there, mental retardation. This act was amended in 2000, but there to favor community living over institutions, but the amendments were never funded, so this is the legal status quo in Israel. Now, just a little bit of figures, 33,589 people are registered at the Ministry of Welfare and Social Services in Israel as persons who have intellectual and developmental disabilities. About a fifth of this registered population, registered, I mean diagnosed, okay, officially diagnosed, they reside in institutions. We have 63 institutions in Israel. Okay, now you'll ask me, what is an institution in Israel? Institutions in Israel consist of 56 to 200 people, okay? The minimum is 56, the maximum is 200 people. And I want to talk a little bit about just a brief history what's happening in Israel in terms of institutions and other community residences for persons with intellectual disabilities. So institutional care in Israel emerged even prior to the establishment of the State of Israel, which was established in 1948. In 1969, we had our first community house, which we name in Hebrew hostel. In the 1990s, there was an expansion of community-based residences, but I must say that although these alternatives did emerge in the 1980s, the place of institutions was never delegitimized, okay? Institutions were also legitimate solutions for people with intellectual disabilities. In 1993, there was a change in policy considering only children with intellectual disabilities, where parents, according to this policy, parents of children with intellectual disabilities could choose where they want their children to live, okay, in institutions or in the community. Okay, what do we have now in terms of residences for people with intellectual disabilities, apart from the 63 institutions that I mentioned? We have apartments, which house up to 6 people, group homes that house up to 18 persons, satellites, which house up to 24 persons. These three account for 3.7% of all persons with intellectual disabilities serve. And we have hostels that house up to 34 individuals. My point is, while we're talking about 63 official institutions, as you can see from these numbers and this slide, which shows what are institutions according to other countries' definitions, many of the community-based residences can be our actual mini institutions. And of course, I want to say that it's not only the size, but also the mentality of the institution. Okay, just a second. Okay, I want to tell you a little bit briefly about the changes that have occurred in Israel and looking into the future. 2011 marked a year of change. Okay, the then Ministry of Welfare and Social Services asked to appoint an international committee of experts that will look into the institutions in Israel, in a nutshell, compare the situation in Israel to other countries, and suggest what to do about the institutions in Israel. Okay, in this slide, which I won't read, are the members of the experts committee that then took hold in Israel between June 12th and June 16th of 2011. Okay, I will not go through this slide also because of the shortness of time, but these are the central issues that were raised to the experts committee to review. As you can see, the core issues are, let's see where Israel stands in comparison to other countries, and the other thing is suggest what we should do with our institutions, okay? Now, these experts relied on two bodies of knowledge for their recommendations. The first is the CRPD, and the second is the extensive literature and social sciences about deinstitutionalization, about community housing versus deinstitutionalization. I'll just say in a nutshell that this, the body of research shows almost unanimously that in all indicators, it's better to live in the community. However, we must say that it's better to live in, the community, I mean to shut down institutions, but shutting down institutions does not merely mean making people live in the community. They have to be truly included. All these studies emphasize this point. It's not merely the number of people residing in the same social space. Okay. Okay, I just wanted to say one thing for your knowledge, that Israel by then did not ratify the CRPD. It was ratified only in September 2012. Okay, now this is the main recommendation that the committee has issued to the Israeli government. Which says that Israel should ultimately and gradually close all institutions for persons with intellectual disabilities and focus on creating community-based services for this population that should promote community inclusion and facilitate choice and self-determination. Gradually, in parentheses, 10 years. A 10-year process, okay? Just hold on a second. Okay. Now, the sad story is this wonderful report, almost 100 pages, was shelved, okay? And it wasn't made publicly known. It was, shelved, okay. A turning point. There is some optimism here. After approximately 4 years, a new minister was appointed. By then, disability advocates, the media, and also some advocates who have raised the issue at the Israeli parliament, named the Knesset, started to gather make a lot of noise around this report. So the then new appointed minister looked into the report, wanted to study the subject. During May 2014, Professor Gerard Quinn invited Israeli officials, government officials, on a study tour to Brussels and Dublin. They came here, and I don't know what they did, but it worked somehow magic. Okay? And after this tour, the new appointed minister fully adopted the recommendations of the then shelved report, which has then became public. Okay. And now official documents of the Ministry of Welfare and Social Affairs talk about deinstitutionalizing between 2016 and 2018, 900 people, okay? I want to say in a nutshell that this process will be monitored by research, which I will take part in. I don't want to get into the research because we still haven't researched anything yet. 2 days after I land in Israel, I hope to meet government representatives and see what their plan is, what they're going to do. But anyway, if somebody wants to hear a little bit about the research program, I will gladly elaborate. Okay, let's see at the targeted population for deinstitutionalization that the ministry has said, okay. This is the kiss of death. No, not yet. Okay. you can judge for yourselves. This is a literal translation, so it's residents of institutions and hostels, mind you, who can live in the community and can be well integrated in community living. Okay. So I want to talk a little bit about, I wanted to talk about the accomplishments, but I have no time and I'm pessimistic, so I'll talk about only about the challenges. But the accomplishments are in the slide. It talks, it communicates with the former panel we had, Article 12 of the CRPD, just so you'll know, finally in March 2016, the Knesset, the Israeli parliament, has voted for the favor of the amendment of the legal capacity and guardianship law of 1962. And you can read more about these points, and I've also given you a link here to the Israeli Human Rights Center for Persons with Disabilities, so you can see, check out more about their work. Now let's be pessimistic, as I always am. Okay. What are the challenges that Israel faces, I say? Okay. Let's look at Article 19, and I checked a little bit about a little bit of definitions of community and social sciences. And in social sciences, community means interrelated components of place, people, and sense of membership or belonging. And I think this captures also the spirit of the CRPD. It's more than mere or just spatial presence. It's really being a part of the social fabric. Okay, now. Bear with me a moment. I want to say a little bit about Article 8, because I think our challenges are also here. What I'm trying to say is that the social construction and cultural construction of intellectual disability in Israel is still something we must overcome or we must change. I'll give it in bullet points. Akim is one of our greatest the largest service provider for persons with intellectual disabilities. Every year they make this, they have this mini survey they call the Inclusion Index. Just, this is the latest data from 2016. This is a representative sample of Israeli adults. 25% of the population said that persons with intellectual disabilities must be kept in separate settings, okay? And look at the other number, approximately 60% pity persons with intellectual disabilities. This talks a lot about also the medicalization of intellectual disability in Israel. To say mentally retarded in Israel in a medical context, it's not derogatory. It's almost legitimate. There is a slow shift in the language. My last point is that also in Israel, mental retardation is also a metaphor. I've written the Hebrew words here, pigur or pigur sikhli. It's a metaphor. It's a kind of a curse. It stands for telling someone you're extremely stupid. You're extremely incapable. I mean, in language, that's how we speak about that. There's a quote here from Susan Sontag who talked about illness as metaphor. And I think that this is the major hurdle of that we're now facing in this process, really changing the way people think about this population, not merely closing down institutions and putting them in the community. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes. Oh, no. Elizabeth, you're next.
Okay. So my presentation today is on what community living means in Africa, and once again, a small footnote. Big continent, very difficult to generalize, but so I'll try and be very specific when I mean a specific country, and so yeah, just to state that up front. From all the speakers who've spoken before, one of the things that comes out so clearly is that institutionalization of people with disabilities is widespread and sort of entrenched. In many African countries, and specifically in Kenya, institutionalization hasn't been the way we've approached issues of people with disabilities, and I will explain later where institutionalization occurs, because it does. But for now, as a general approach to intellectual disabilities, in specific, the issue usually is that the person is located in the community, but they are cut off from community life. So usually the main issue is an issue of people living within their family, within the community physically, but not taking part in community life. However, having said that, let me go into this now. Sorry, one more thing. An issue that again has been said again and again is the issue of guardianship. The idea that people with disabilities are put under guardianship, then put in institutions, or at the same time that happens, that link between guardianship and institutionalization. Now, once again, to state that many people with disabilities in Africa, certainly I know for sure in Kenya, are not under guardianship formally. There is hardly, I've been doing some research now trying to look at case law on guardianship in Kenya, and I only came across 10 cases of people with disabilities being put under guardianship. You may think, oh, that's good, that means people are making decisions. No, it does not. It just means they are being restricted by other forces other than the law. So we have guardianship in our laws, but very often the reason people are not making decisions is because the family says, you can't. The community says or frowns upon people with disabilities taking decisions, or because you can't even get out of the house to go to the place where you're supposed to implement the decision in the first place. Do you know what I mean? Accessibility issues, sort of the challenges are quite a complete set of challenge other than as we know it, being under guardianship. So moving on then to the slides. So the Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities has so far issued concluding observations to 5 African states: Kenya, Uganda, Gabon, Mauritius, and Tunisia. And on Article 19 of each one of those countries, these are the most common things that the committee has said to the countries to do or to change or has expressed concern about. And these are the issues I'm going to talk about: lack of community-based services, isolation and segregation from the community within families, institutionalization of persons with disabilities, so we'll see how that happens in the African context, and lack of support measures for persons with disabilities who have no families. So those are the sort of key things that the committee has flagged so far. So many of you might know that African states are in the process of developing an African protocol on the rights of people with disabilities. So a specific African disability rights protocol, so over and above the CRPD. So when Professor Quinn, when I got the invitation to talk about this, what does community living in the community mean in Africa, I said the best place to look what it means in Africa is at the draft protocol on the rights of people with disabilities in Africa. So what is different between the protocol, the African protocol, and the CRPD? I thought that would be like an important way to know then what is this we are adding as a continent, what is this that be over and beyond the CRPD, we've decided like we need an African protocol to address these specific issues on living in the community. And I'll go into that right now. So the first thing that, and this is Article 10 of the draft protocol on the rights of persons with disabilities, The first thing that it says is that people with disabilities should have the opportunity to choose their place of residence, where and with whom they live, on an equal basis with others. So that's exactly what the CRPD says. So no big change there, but that allows me to speak about the form that institutionalization takes in Africa. So institutionalization is often and very much occurs in the context of people with psychosocial disabilities. In nearly every African state, you will find one or two really, truly horrendous mental health institutions where everybody from the entire country, that's where they receive mental health care. So for people with psychosocial disabilities, institutionalization is a reality for them in Africa as well. Institutionalization also takes the form of prayer camps or healing camps, so-called prayer camps or healing camps, where people, again, with psychosocial disabilities are put together, apparently, to be prayed for, but actually often end up being sometimes starved in the name of fasting, or similar to Indonesia yesterday that we saw about shackling, that also happens. And there's a human rights report, Human Rights Watch report on this issue in Ghana. So that's a different form of institutionalization that we have on the continent. The other, and this is contentious, but the other issue is to do with special schools for people with disabilities. So ordinarily, you wouldn't think of them, or maybe you would, as institutions, but where there's only one school for the deaf in a country, and all the deaf children, all the children who are deaf, are taken to this one school, cut off from community life, hundreds of miles away from home, and some of them hardly ever hardly have the fare to return home back and forth. They end up spending, sometimes children may end up spending years there. And in a way, then you have to say, it is an aspect of institutionalization. And the committee said this very thing to Mauritius, with regard to changing certain centers that are there for children, so-called children in distress, who are children with disabilities, who are being afforded education in separate settings that are actually institutions. So this was recognized by the committee as well. So Article 10B is different from the CRPD of the draft protocol, as you will see. It states that people with disabilities who require intensive support and their families should have, state parties should ensure that these people have adequate and appropriate facilities and services, including carers and respite services. So you don't find this level of detail in the CRPD, and in part, you don't find families actually very explicitly mentioned in the CRPD. But in the African context, it's the feeling is that if you try to separate the person from their family and completely focus only on the rights of the person with a disability, you run the risk of not really actually achieving what it is that you're trying to achieve in the absence of state supported of state services. So it's kind of like recognizing that families are the bridge through which, in many cases, people with disabilities access rights. So families have found mention in the draft protocol not once but a number of times, but I won't go into that now given the time constraints. So the other issue is this is exactly the same as in the CRPD. It says that persons with disabilities, state parties should ensure that persons with disabilities have access to a range of in-home, residential, and other community support services necessary to support living and inclusion in the community. And this is so important because actually to nearly each of the countries, the committee has reviewed, this has been a recommendation, not to upgrade, but to actually develop community support services. Like a lot of countries on the continent simply do not have community support services for people with disabilities at all. And this is the huge problem, and this is one of the main reasons why people with disabilities are so isolated, even if they're living in the community, because there simply aren't support services available for them within the community. And so this is not to say This is not to say that there isn't work happening among DPOs on this issue. There is. DPOs come in to fill what is ideally supposed to be a state role. The other provision under Article 10 that's not in the CRPD is the requirement that states parties are required to ensure that persons with disabilities have personal mobility with the greatest possible independence. So over and beyond the provision on accessibility, if you heard my colleague from Uganda yesterday, Apollo, talking about inaccessibility hurdles within Uganda, you see how much the linkage between Article 19 and Article 9 is in a country where, because of rough terrain, because of inaccessible houses, because of so many reasons, people with disabilities simply are not part of the community. And this was said by our colleagues from Georgia as well, actually, in their presentation. So this is one of the other sort of difference in the draft protocol for the rights of persons with disabilities in Africa. The other thing that is different between the CRPD and the African draft protocol that shows what community living means in Africa is that it provides at E that states parties should ensure that community-based rehabilitation services are provided in ways that enable the participation and inclusion of persons with disabilities in the community. So we don't have any mention of community-based rehabilitation centers under Article 19 of the Convention, but actually if you look at the state reports of African states to the CRPD committee, what they report under Article 19 mostly is activities towards community-based rehabilitation. And this is because CBR, as it's often called in development circles, is the key way through which the attempts have been made to have people with disabilities included in the community. And there's a feeling growing among, you know, people with disabilities actually and their organizations that CBR or community-based rehabilitation can be very medical model, very aimed at fixing people and not really coming from a rights perspective, and that it embodies an approach sometimes, not always, but sometimes traditionally at least, embodies an approach of doing to people, 3 minutes, of doing to people rather than working together with involving people with disabilities in solutions for them. It kind of often comes packaged as, we know what's right for you, so you know these are the things that you should do. The other explicit aspect is that is different between the protocol and the convention is that so state parties are required to ensure that community living centers are organized and established by persons with disabilities, are supported to provide training, peer support, personal assistance services, and other services to persons with disabilities. So we don't actually have a personal assistance service for people with disabilities in Kenya at all. Like, it simply does not exist. So we are talking about just starting from like scratch. And so it's recognizing the role of people with disabilities in this issue. Already there are peer support groups, particularly among people with psychosocial disabilities. That's one of the areas where there's a growing move towards peer support groups, but usually they are organized by DPOs. They are not state funded at all. It's basically a lot of states have, you know, left it to people and their families and are not seeing this as a part of what they should do and part of what they're obligated to do. In fact, I think Tanzania's Persons with Disabilities Act actually places an obligation on families and makes it a crime for family members not to assist their family member with a disability. And you're looking at it and thinking, families? It's the state that is supposed to be responsible for this. And finally, the final difference is that it states explicitly the community services that should be made accessible to persons with disabilities. So G states that states parties should ensure that community services and facilities for the general population, including health, social, and education services, are available on an equal basis to persons with disabilities and are responsive to their needs. So kind of just going a bit more into details. So I wanted to say just one last thing before my colleague speaks, which is that if you want to see, to kind of really see an accessible, it was part of the work that people with disabilities are doing. There's a colleague and an OSF scholar, an Open Society Foundation scholar called Edmo Masendeke, and he's built the first accessible house in Zimbabwe and put it online. So if you Google, it is not yet sweet home for people with disabilities in Zimbabwe, and his name is Edmo, E-D-M-O-R-E. You'll see just kind of how novel this whole discussion is for us on the continent. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now we're going to switch to Europe and a view of creating accessible communities there. Yeah. Go ahead, Meg.
Which one? All right. Okay, if you can just help me. So the title of my presentation is Europe, How to Shift from the Stubborn Persistence of Institutions Towards Creating Inclusive Communities. It is very important to emphasize that despite from outside the European Union may seem a human rights paradise, and I think in many ways it is, there are still a lot of people are living in institutions and in institutional settings or with their families, which can be like an institution. But what I'm going to talk to you about, I will not answer this question in a definitive way, especially not in the 10 minutes given to me today. I would have done otherwise if I can speak 15. But I will try to bring some elements that are important to make deinstitutionalization successful and to move towards community living. And I will give it from a Brussels-based NGO perspective. The European Union is very far from many of its citizens, so it might be also interesting to see for you how an NGO at EU level can advocate for the implementation of the CRPD. And, And I work for COFACE, Families Europe, but I've been also working with other DPOs in Brussels. And just a few words who we are. We are a family organization. We represent all kinds of families. We were established in 58. We have members in 23 EU countries for altogether 59 organizations. And we are funded by the EU, so I could really relate to the diversification of funding issues that was mentioned earlier. It is a challenge at EU level for all NGOs working on human rights and disability rights and in general. We focus on a number of areas, so disability rights is very important because a lot of our members are families representing persons with disabilities or persons with disabilities themselves who have a family. But we work on other areas because we have members representing poor people, migrant people, other minorities, so we work a lot on education, social policies. I would start with the role of families in the area of disability rights, and I'm actually very happy that this topic has been brought up several times because, as you all know, families are recognized in the preamble of the CRPD. And in our membership, there are a lot of families representing persons with disabilities, and what we see from their example is that when there is a violation of rights or a lack of support for the individual, it does affect the whole family. And we therefore believe that solutions somehow should tackle the problems of the family very often. I give you a very concrete example. If there is a child in a family who would need early childhood care or intervention, what happens very often in Europe is that if this support is not available near where the parents are living, and let's say it's, these are parents living from agriculture in a rather rural area, if the service is not available in the community, either the child has to move to a bigger town and be institutionalized, or the family has to move, often facing unemployment and poverty. So just to give you an idea why we, for example, think that the family approach can be and is very important. I'm trying to... here it is. So I brought three main points where COFACE is working on independent living. We think that family members are important key stakeholders. On one hand, for what was already raised before, because it's important that families are aware of the human rights of persons with disabilities, that they are open enough and understand why it's, for example, important to enroll their kid in an inclusive school. But it's also that families are raising the next generation of disability advocates. So the awareness raising for families on disability rights is crucial. And in our work, we are really trying to take a life course approach because persons with disabilities are not only children in families. They grow up and then they want to have their own family. So we work also on parenting rights for persons with disabilities. And what is very important to recognize a holistic support to families and family carers, because often in cases where support and services are not available, the care falls on the families. And it usually ends in either way that the family member who has to provide care is out of the labor market, and it has, as you can imagine, very long-term, very serious consequences, or that's actually one of the reasons why we still have institutions all over Europe, because there is no other resource for the families. It's a slide about the reality in Europe. Of course, reality is a lot more complicated than this, but it's just a few elements to give you the context where we work at EU level when it comes to independent living. We shouldn't forget that in 2009 there was the economic crisis, recession, austerity measures have been set by EU member states' governments that hit persons with disabilities and their families disproportionately in terms of serious cuts in disability benefits. And just in general, social dimension wasn't a priority. In parallel to this, there is an ongoing misuse of EU funding, and I will not go into details because I know that Alex, in the following presentation, will cover this in more detail. But what is really true that it's still over 1 million people are living in institutions with disabilities, but it's not only persons with disabilities in Europe who are living in institutions, but it's also children who are often not covered in national deinstitutionalization plans. I would like to underline this because that's really a striking trend in many European countries. Other people and a lot of other people with different care needs are institutionalized currently in the European Union. Institutions are often in rural areas, and I bring this in because I participated recently in a research with three other independent researcher colleagues, one of them, Gábor Petri, sitting in the audience, and we just published the research report on the Hungarian DI, and that's just a side note that one of the things we saw as well, that institutions are often in rural places, so it's not that easy when you think of closing them down. What happens with the people who work there, because these are the institutions which are the only and the main employers. And having said that, institutions must be closed down. There is no doubt on that. And of course, COFACE's work and all these NGOs working in Brussels on disability rights, are the basis of our work is the CRPD. But just to point out that while in Western Europe, it often happened that everyone was fired, basically, and they got skilled new staff. In many Central Eastern European countries, as a trend, what we see that even if the manager, the head of the institution, receives some funding from the EU to recruit new skilled staff, social workers, for example, to become personal assistants for people who move out of the institutions, there is nobody who would even want to come to these areas. And it's a very unpopular decision to apply for EU fundings to do DI, and I think it's just something we have to also consider when we plan our advocacy to deal with it. There has been an ineffective monitoring of the spending of structural funds in the last programming period, and it's also a very striking trend that there is no real follow-up or assessment on the actual impact of the spending of EU money and the deinstitutionalizations on people's life. And I mean really under that, whether it's a one-time investment or is it a sustainable contribution to create inclusive societies, meaning that what happens when someone is moving out of the institution, is there any flexibility if the person isn't happy wherever he or she is living, and that's very, very important. And this slide is basically the it's a bit messed up, but I try to tell you what, well, I don't know what happened, but basically, that's the core of what I try to say, that it's very important to see what is happening before, and but actually the mess up makes sense now that I look at it. So what I try to do is to put two columns, because it's important to see why people get in institutions and how we could prevent that. And I just put a list of things, for example, the lack of family support, lack of awareness raising, lack of early childhood care and intervention, lack of inclusive education, lack of accessible mainstream social services, lack of employment, lack of quality health care. And if we think that all these things are there on the side that causes that people end up in an institution, when we think of, okay, the institutionalization is happening, EU is giving us money, that's all great, but if the very same things are not available when people move out and want to start their life independent in the community, what would happen is that it's really people get back to institution, and reinstitutionalization is also something happening all over Europe. It's just one example of what, for example, COFACE is doing in the area of family cares. I expected this topic would come up because we, the work done and we published the European Charter for Family Carers. I will not go into details. You can see it, it's available online. But I think what is just important to point out that, for example, we advocate both for the recognition of family carers and for them to be provided with social rights, benefits, and pension. Because it is something we have to realize that a lot of family members do caring tasks, stay out of the labor market, lacks income, faces poverty, and also if you think that if someone has been a family carer for 10, 20 years, it's a waste amount of your active working career, and if this is not paid when you go retired, and this is again the reality in many, if not most, European countries, that's very striking on the growing aging population, what it will cause economically and, you know, socially, really, for a lot of people. But we, in line with the CRPD, we don't think that family care should be the only choice, and a lot of family carers do not want to be full-time family carers, and I think that's also a misunderstood concept. It's a very important duty that they step in to avoid often institutionalization of their family member. And for that reason, we advocate in parallel for the improvement, development of mainstream social services in the community. And in our mind, the idea word would be where there is enough flexibility that if someone, a person with disability, wants to have a family member to take care in certain time, temporarily, in certain situation, that should be possible, and in, for this time, social rights benefits payment should be provided for the family carer, and in the remaining time, there should be all these community-based services available for the person. I'm jumping a little bit because I wanted to just provoke you because, of course, there is a lot of ways how we can achieve change, and at EU level, we could organize demonstrations, burn cars, and do a lot of exciting or violent things. But in Brussels, life is often more boring, although we have quite a lot of demonstrations and lockdowns, unfortunately, recently. But what I just wanted to give you as a very concrete example is the European Expert Group on Transition from Institutional to Community-Based Care, which is a large, a broad coalition of different NGOs representing persons with disabilities, but also other groups, homeless people, children, families, service providers. There is a list of participants. Also, UNICEF is member, and the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights is also a strong supporter. It's a broad coalition that was established in 2009, and we are an informal advisory body for European institutions and states in relation to institutional care, and I just wrote down some of the activities that we are doing recently. Recently in the last couple of years. And I think the good thing about this coalition is that it gained acknowledgement by the European institutions, so by governments of EU member states, because it's a big, big coalition with lots of expertise through our membership. It's all grassroots organizations. I mean, COFACE, for example, represents 100 million people through our membership, and all the other NGOs have equally huge membership, and What we do, for example, is giving training to European Commission officials, not only those who work on disability, but also, for example, those desk officers who are dealing with EU funding or other relevant areas. We also started a task force a few years ago on deinstitutionalization in the West, because there has been a lot of finger pointing on East Central Eastern European countries for the persistence of institutions, which is very true, but it's also true that in Western Europe there are institutions, many, many people are living in institutions. These institutions are shinier, I don't argue on that, than the ones in Eastern Europe, but they are institutions and they should be locked down as well. And we do a lot of communication and awareness raising to mainstream DI across EU policies. And we organize country seminars in EU member states where different civil society groups, government representatives, and experts from Brussels, from the civil society and policymaking level can gather together and discuss how to make DI successful. And we also do joint meetings in Brussels with important stakeholders. And I'm finishing up. I just wrote this. We developed the guideline and the toolkit on the transition from institutional to community-based care. It's available online. You can download it. And just to finish up, because I will certainly... Yeah, but... The presentation will be shared, and it's in the literature list. that it's very important to take a holistic approach to DI in order to develop high-quality services in the community, social services, education, health services, and of course to put immediately a moratorium, because that's a big problem that there is still new entry, and that is basically when I talk about reinstitutionalization, and to make mainstream services accessible and available, not only in big cities, but also in rural areas, to avoid that people with disabilities and their families are facing very vulnerable situation. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. And please send me an email if you have any further questions or you need any more information about the expert group of, or about our own activity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We're going to stay in Europe. And Alexandra is going to talk about using European taxpayer monies to help in this process.
Okay, cool. Okay, hi everyone. I'm going to be talking about the structural funds regulation. So these are new regulations, 2014 to 2020, and it's about using the structural funds to end institutionalization and, more importantly, develop community-based support services. So I'll give just a really quick backdrop, and we'll get into the funds specifically, and the sort of provisions of the regulations, and you know, looking at how those can end institutional care, hopefully. Okay, so the new framework basically is the result of some really concerted advocacy on the part of many organizations, and it does represent quite a historic change on paper. So as an absolute, the regulations and the guidance documents clearly embrace the view that the transition from institutional care to community-based living, it responds to rights, not just needs. And it is mandatory. And the guidelines, they draw very heavily from the European Expert Group, guidelines in, you know, sort of definitions and that kind of thing, which is good. So this was really sort of pushed through, this advocacy for the new framework was pushed through because of previous funding being used to build institutions. obviously the EU has ratified or technically confirmed the CRPD, so it's subject, it has to repeal or amend laws or policies that are inconsistent with the CRPD, and that's Article 4 of the CRPD. And the committee has brought this up in several concluding observations and recommendations that to EU member states that they need to abide by this new framework and use the funds for the transition. So basically what I want to get across here is that the union is very diverse, so between the member states and within the member states, you know, similar to that urban-rural divide. So a core aim of the EU, it's set out in the Treaty of the Functioning of the European Union, and that is to pursue economic, social, and territorial cohesion. And this is to be supported and achieved by the funds. So the budget is huge. The overall budget, it's 182 billion. But basically a third of that, yeah, I know. A third of that, okay, don't get too excited though, but because I guess, so a third of that is basically dedicated to what is called cohesion policy, and that's for the 2040 to 2020 period. So it's 351.8 billion euro is going into the union between this period of 2014 to 2020. And this is the principal investment tool for delivering the Europe 2020 strategy. So this is a growth and development strategy in the EU, and it's for smart, sustainable, and inclusive growth. And it's recognizing that, you know, there's been a movement in the policy to recognize that growth and development is multidimensional. You need the smart, you need the sustainable, and you need the inclusive. So Europe 2020 was launched in 2010, and one of its main targets, it aims to lift 20 million people out of poverty and social exclusion by 2020. Okay, so I'll just skip through this. Okay, so cohesion policy, it's delivered through three funds. So the European Regional Development Fund, the European Social Fund, and the Cohesion Fund. Now, these three funds, plus the European Agricultural Fund for Rural Development and the European Maritime Fisheries Fund, those make up the structural funds. So there's five altogether, but what we're really interested in is two of those. So our focus is the Regional Development Fund and the European Social Fund. And why are we interested in those? Well, the ERDF, that's all about infrastructure and building. So the funds can and should be used, for example, the development of accessible housing in the community, the development or adaptation of social, health, and education infrastructure for providing community-based services. So that's the sort of infrastructure building part. And then you have the European Social Fund, which is investment in people. So, for example, funds should be used for drawing up action plans for the transition that include an individualized care plan for each person. Or, for instance, developing an integrated network of community-based services. And this would include specific services, personal assistance, but it also includes making mainstream services accessible and available to everyone. So this is what should happen. So the funding is co-financed, so it's not just the EU giving a load of money, it's the national finances are in this too. And the likely impact of that is up to 600 billion euro. So it's divided out under principle of solidarity, so the less developed member states would receive more funding than the more developed states. So all the member states are classified of what their region is. So they're less developed, transitional, or more developed. So what is the new framework? So the regulations we're interested in. So there's a common provision regulation, and this is an overarching regulation, and it contains general provisions that are applicable to all of the funds. So it's one set of rules. So for instance, so basically, this sets out that every member state has to have what's called a partnership agreement, and that's basically an overarching strategy at national level, and it says, right, okay, what is our need? We identify the need in the country, and what do we, what do we want to, what is the planned use of the funds? After this, there's operational programs. So there can be operational programs for one fund, or there can be an overall huge, like single multi-fund program that programs all of the funds. And this basically translates the objectives in the partnership agreement into concrete action. So what are we actually going to do? Following this, the member states have to basically designate management and control bodies. So the main one is the managing authority, and there's a certifying authority and an audit authority, and they would manage and control how the funds are spent. The selection of projects is done by the managing authority in the member state. So, and this is also followed up by annual reporting and progress reports. So the common provision regulation sets out 11 thematic objectives, and these are the objectives the funds have to achieve. And these are linked back to the Europe 2020 strategy. So on the blue is the focus for the European Social Fund. On the left, you've got the sort of research and innovation, information communication. That's more the Regional Development Fund. But these 11 thematic objectives, the most important one that you would zone in on is thematic objective 9, and that's social inclusion, combating poverty and any discrimination. So this is where the shift from institutional care to community-based services is programmed and funded. Okay, so the common provision regulation is basically complemented by fund-specific regulations. So there's a regulation for the European Social Fund and a regulation for the European Regional Development Fund. And, okay, so just to explain, these fund-specific regulations, they specify the type of activities that each fund should be supporting, and these are called investment priorities, and for achieving thematic objective 9, social inclusion. So the ESF, for instance, a member state can choose from the investment priorities and say, okay, active inclusion, including with a view to promoting equal opportunities, active participation, or enhancing access to affordable, sustainable, and high-quality services. It's a lot easier with an example. So, for example, with Bulgaria. So Bulgaria has chosen, one of their investment priorities they've chosen is under the European Social Fund, and it's enhance access to affordable, sustainable, and high quality services, including healthcare and social services. So what they do with that investment priority is they break it down and they say, okay, what are our specific objectives that we want to get from that investment priority, and what are we going to fund? So Bulgaria has chosen 3 specific objectives under this investment priority. The first is improving access of people with disabilities and people over 65 years of age to social inclusion and health services. The second, reducing the number of elderly people and people with disabilities placed in institutions by providing community-based social and health services, including long-term care services. So these are broken down into sort of specific objectives, but those are the main sort of regulations that are really to be focused on. Okay, so I'll talk really quickly just about on an overall aspect of the regulations, of the sort of reforms that they introduce. So the new framework really, there's a focus on results and performance in the member states. The member states are really incentivized to reach their targets. So in those specific objectives, they'd have specific indicators, and they're incentivized through a performance reserve to reach those targets. So 6% of the operational program is held back, and if the member state is achieving its milestones through its projects, then they receive that 6%. And 6% doesn't sound a lot, but the money is a very large amount. So there's a real enhanced role for the European Social Fund. So member states have to spend 20% of their European Social Fund allocation on measures for social inclusion. So one main quite important thing, and something that's been missed by quite a lot of member states, but there's huge provision for innovation in the regulations. So especially in the European Social Fund. So it specifies that social innovation should be promoted through all areas of action that are supported by the Social Fund. So it's particularly testing, evaluating, scaling up innovative solutions to address social needs. So member states either identified in their operational programs fields for social innovation that correspond with their specific needs, or they can do it at a later stage during implementation. And that's important to remember from an advocacy perspective, that that can happen. Okay, so a very big reform is that the regulations envision a really strong role for social partners. So who are the partners? Basically, it specifies in those regs that you have public authorities, trade unions, employers, and relevant bodies representing civil society, NGOs, bodies responsible for promoting social inclusion, gender equality, and non-discrimination. So this is really important. You know, there's this movement to actually engage and bring in sort of civil society. So the partners must be involved in the planning, the implementation, the monitoring, and the evaluation stages of projects. So partners, it's divided through. So each partner would have a position on like the monitoring committee that would monitor the projects and would have a voting right. So there's also provision in the regulations that there has to be provided capacity building for the partners to effectively, engage and, be able to, engage in the process of monitoring. And I think I left the main one to the end, but a particularly innovative introduction by the regulations are the ex-ante conditionalities. So these are, conditions. These were introduced to make sure that all the sort of institutional and strategic policy arrangements are in place in the member state before funding is released. These are conditions. So looking at developing regulatory frameworks, effective policy frameworks, strategies, and sufficient administrative and institutional capacity. So thematic objective 9 is linked to the ex ante conditionality 9.1. So basically what this means is that member states had to assess whether this condition applied to them and whether it had a direct impact on their specific objectives. So the condition is that there is the existence and implementation of a national strategic policy framework, I'm sorry, for, I'm nearly done, for poverty reduction. And just to point out a main, the criteria of fulfillment, there are five criteria for fulfillment. And one of those is, depending on identified needs, includes measures for the shift from institutional to community-based care. So let me just see. I've run out of time, but I know that's a lot of information, and it's sort of quite complicated, but I was thinking about, okay, how, you know, can I sort of, you know, try and draw this together and you know, say, okay, where are we now? And I thought of rock climbing for some reason. So basically, when you go rock climbing, you need sort of footholds and you need a good grip, right? And you're leveraging your weight, okay, to get up, okay? So from my strange perspective, it was a dream actually, basically the footholds are really what's in the regulations. So the provision for partnership, the conditions that are there, the fact that the funds need to, you know, be used together, the very firm of the guidance and the regulations that say the funds have to support community-based social services. And, you know, this is the way with the regulations and the reforms hanging on, and we can leverage those funds to end institutional care. And now it's really turned to making this happen. All of the operational programs have been adopted, and the focus has turned to implementation. So, and there are some links and that sort of thing for more. Okay, sorry, too long. Sorry.
We're nearly at the end. There's time for questions. Our friends from Georgia decided that, given the evening and the fact that they've been in several other panels, that they're here to answer questions, but they won't do a presentation on this panel. And you can thank them for that when you're. Are there questions for any of our panelists on the subject? Yes, sir.
Thank you for your presentation. Two quick questions. Maybe for all of you. The first one is, how do you see the potential of the SDGs and what are you are saying about funding and money and also inclusive societies? And the second question for Europe is, do you think about the potential to work in your advocacy to have all of your work implemented outside the border of Europe? Because, for example, in Madagascar, when they have Europe have a very huge program in education, children with disabilities are not included in this program, and it's exclusively for other children. And do you think about how to make an advocacy for this? Thanks.
Just briefly on the SDGs, that some of you might know that the European Commission launched the European Pillar of Social Rights Consultation, which will be most likely the overarching framework for the next years that will guide EU social policy. And I know that there are ongoing discussions how to link this big framework potentially to the SDGs. So that's just answering your question. The second question, I think at EU level advocacy, What is the main guiding line is that the EU ratified the CRPD, and the 27 member states which ratified the CRPD as well, apart from Ireland, and let's hope that will happen soon. What is the main challenge is to see what falls under EU competence, what is a shared competence with the member states, and what is not a competence at all for the EU, so it remains with the member states. And on the top of everything, the EU is the biggest donor in international development. So for example, with the EEG, of course, we try to involve in this training that I mentioned, desk officers in the European Commission who are working on, for example, international development. But again, from an NGO perspective at EU level, your main constituency is basically to advocate for the interest of your membership, but definitely it's a very valid point that we have to look beyond the borders of the EU as well.
Yes.
Thank you so much for these presentations. I come from an organization of older persons, so my experience and my comment comes from this perspective. However, I'm sure that there are commonalities with people with disabilities. So what we witness in the sector is that the majority of older persons are actually being cared for at home, often by informal carers, their families. And don't get me wrong, there are obviously problems in institutions, and our members are very much advocating for aging in place. However, I'm wondering how much of this process of deinstitutionalization takes into account what is actually happening within the community. Because what we witness is that there is a large number of abuses that happen in the community, be it both by informal caregivers that have to do with what you described, Mike, that has to do with they do not receive adequate support, they're exhausted, and they actually their own the rights are also not respected, but also when it comes to professional carers where there's not enough training or resources available in the community. So I'm just wondering how much of this process, of course there's monitoring about to avoid reinstitutionalization, but is there a follow-up in this process about what is happening in the community in other countries outside of Europe as well? But
On the training, and I think it is very important what you raised, and what we, for example, saw in this research that deals mostly with the first six DI projects in Hungary is that often training to staff is given before people actually move out, and then there is no real follow-up than when actually they switch from a carer role to a personal assistant, so to speak. How will they be able to react, respect human rights, provide quality care and support? And right now, this is something I cannot really see funded from EU money. The money basically stops when people move out, and everything that can be done before is done by the money. Again, it's questionable how it's done, and there are problems with the monitoring at that level. But once people are out, there is no real guarantee that their rights will not continue to be violated.
Let me answer that question from the perspective of the United States. When we started deinstitutionalization, we had that problem. We just said, all right, you're out of the institution, you're on your own. We've learned that that was the wrong process for some of the reasons that you're talking about. Now, for every person that leaves an institution, there has to be an individual plan for that person. The monies that provided for that person to be in the institution go with the person as they are, so there's continued funding, and there is a whole program of follow-up, but all of this depends upon the existence of accessible housing in the community, community services, community supports, and we're really in the United States just beginning to develop those so that, as Michal talked about, that we're not just changing the place where the person is, but we're giving them a life in the community with all of what that means. Other question, Judy? And then we'll come to the gentleman from Switzerland. Oh, okay, either one, but we're gonna do both, so.
So I think this issue of what's happening with older people is very important, and let me also say that in the United States, anyone who's been in an institution and is being removed to go into the community typically has an entity that has responsibility for that work happening. Mm-hmm. And therefore, they are held accountable for what's happening in the community. The problem is that there are many people who are living, and I think we raised this yesterday, there are many people that are living in the community or isolated in the community, may never be in a typical institution, as may be happening in continents like Africa, where there aren't community-based services. And I think that's a much larger population of people than we're looking at, and it cuts across the age range. So I think it is an issue that we all need to be looking at.
This gentleman right here.
Thank you for the great presentations. I have a question to the speaker from Israel, since I am part of an association who does independent living for people with disabilities. So they are staying in apartments, but they have the option, if there is an emergency, to call somebody who lives in the house to help them. So basically the idea is of the independent living, but there's some like emergency button that they can put. And my question goes to these apartments that you mentioned and the group homes in Israel. How much support do they live completely independently on those group homes, or do they have support there, or how does the situation look like when they get out of the institutional in those group homes and apartments?
Okay, let me answer this. First of all, the apartments now, because we haven't yet moved into deinstitutionalization, house persons who are highly functioning, as you say. The other thing I wanted to say is, yes, they have supports in place for these individuals. Now we're saying, the low functioning, the persons with challenging behavior, so-called, we have different terminology even for that in Hebrew, and persons who have more complex medical needs are still institutionalized, okay? So I want to make that, we haven't moved this population yet to apartments or other forms of living, but all these apartments, hostels, satellites, whatever they're called, are managed and monitored and supervised by the Ministry of Welfare and Social Affairs. So all supports need to be in place. It's not like they just put six people there and left them to fend for themselves. Okay, I hope this answers the question.
Other questions? Yes, up in the back.
Namaste, Meena from Nepal. This is not a question, this is question. I think this is for the Elizabeth. In Nepal, we are running one rehabilitation center for the women with disabilities who are survivor and then who are orphan. We have not parents and we don't know she has parents or not. So how we can integrate it in that community? If there is the, we have the cerebral palsy, she doesn't know about where she is from. So in our rehabilitation center, someone threw her and we kept in our the rehabilitation center. So how can we integrate in that community to her? And then another case, we have such many of the cases of like that, and one of the deaf girl children with disabilities, some of the persons left in our rehabilitation center. So she is living with us. She is she has no mother, no father, because she is deaf, and she is to know who and where are from. We kept her name and we kept the caste, and so how to integrate it in the community in that case is the one of the questions. And if we talk about the psychosocial disabilities, and because of the stigma with some of the persons, psychosocial disability who is not the house, and we, some of the organization who are working in the sector of psychosocial disabilities, she put, she carried in the hospital, and after treatment, she doesn't know where is the home and who are the families, and so how to deal with that such cases. This is very difficult to in the context of Nepal because of the stigma and the poverty, and family is not accepting the cases.
Elizabeth.
I'm definitely going to look to my colleagues to help me with this one. But I mean, it's a real challenge, and in developing countries, actually, you're either with your family in a context of dependency, if you're not employed, or you're possibly homeless on the streets. The choices are very stark. I know there have been thoughts around, for example, families in rural places who are willing to take on a person, who can be willing to take on a person, but they would need also appropriate support, and they would need, appropriate support. But there are, I think I read a story actually about India, about, and I forget the name of the organization, but the person works in the organization works at finding people who are most vulnerable and finding people around. So say the person who operates the local shop just there and trying to find.
Yeah.
Is it your organization?
No.
Do you?
Oh,
yeah, I mean, if you have any, like any something concrete, like, because I'm speaking kind of off the top.
What they do is they find someone in, if they find someone wandering in the area, they just ask a local tea shop owner or small shop owner to just look after the person, give them a couple of meals, and then they build a relationship of trust and help that person, you know, towards recovery, like, you know, create a community. And in many, many cases, actually, that person ended up working with that person or living with the family or getting, yeah, so that's what their model has been. It's based in Calcutta.
But I think this is a child. Oh.
So it's actually not atypical for families in certain communities to abandon their children who have disabilities. And so I think, you know, the broader issue is really at a country by country level, there are nonprofit organizations that exist in some of these communities to help address the issue of a child in this situation who is an orphan. And I think also the points that have been made about looking at ways of having some financing to be able to get either the family, if it's known, who abandoned the child because it might have been because of lack of resources, or to see if there's another family in rural or urban areas who can do that.
Okay, you have been incredibly patient and persevered through a very long but very challenging and interesting day. I've been told that you'll be perhaps happy to hear, maybe you'll be sad that the breakout sessions for today have been canceled, because we're really at the end of the day now. But I want all of you to think about what Gerard talked to you about this morning, which is thinking about the moot court on Friday and who the representatives of each of the groups should be. So you should be thinking about that. And if you have time this evening, look at the scenario in that regard. Let's give a round of applause to this wonderful panel.